difficult. It was hard.
I was black. I was in a different environment. I wasn't like everyone else. I came to North Carolina to break barriers.
On October 12, 1793, the cornerstone was laid for Old East, which would become the nation's first state university building. From that moment on, the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and African Americans have been inextricably linked. In the 18th and 19th centuries, black slaves, and later those freed, served the university in myriad capacities.
It was soon one morning, death come creeping.
Dred Wimberly, an ex-slave who later served in the General Assembly, cast the deciding vote in the House of Representatives that enabled the university to receive what was then a life-saving $15,000 appropriation. Wilson Caldwell, a slave who later became Chapel Hill's Justice of the Peace, was so revered for his service to the school that a monument was erected in his honor by the class of 1892. The writings of George Moses Horton, a slave from Chatham County, were valued romantic currency in the 1840s. University students would purchase Horton's poems and send them to their sweethearts. As the 20th century dawned and began to unfold, African Americans became even more instrumental in the growth of the university. They were there to lay the foundations and help build many of the university's most venerated edifices. Though a common sight around the campus, blacks were relegated to the role of second-class citizens. Entry to the university as students or faculty was something no one could fathom.
I'd say a famous phrase, capsules what it was like. Ralph Ellison's The Invisible Man. The black experience was invisible here. There were no black faculty members. And at the time, before the first black student, there were no black students either. So it wasn't a hostile environment. I would say it's an environment not conducive to good race relations.
The winds of long-awaited change that were blowing nationally reached Chapel Hill in the summer of 1951. That year, as a result of litigation challenging racial discrimination, Harvey Beach, James Lassiter, Kenneth Lee, Floyd McKissick, and James Walker entered the university's law school. Future Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall was one of the leading civil rights lawyers involved in the litigation.
I think people sometimes forget how massive this was in America itself, and still is in some regions. But I'm very proud of the fact that our people got together. We started out together in this. We said, we're going to make this work, and we're going to set the example for the country to see.
The five new students were acutely aware that having earned entry didn't necessarily mean they were welcome.
From what I gather, they were not really welcome at all. I mean, they were black folks there that were all practical purposes at that point in time. Most of the student body would refer to them as niggers that didn't belong. And they were about treated as niggers that didn't belong. But nevertheless, they'd made the best of that experience. They survived it. They did well.
McKissick, who already had earned his law degree at North Carolina College in Durham, studied just one summer session at the university before going on to national prominence as a civil rights leader. Harvey Beach and Kenneth Lee of the inaugural students would become the first African Americans to earn their diplomas from Chapel Hill, graduating from the School of Law in June of 1952. James Walker graduated in August of 1952. 10 years later, Julius Chambers, destined to become a noted civil rights attorney and educator, graduated number one in his law class and was the first black to become editor of the prestigious North Carolina Law Review. The racial barriers at the medical school were to be broken down by Oscar Diggs, who in 1955 emerged from Carolina as its first African-American doctor of medicine. Later that fall, John Brandon and brothers Leroy and Ralph Frazier arrived as the university's first African-American undergraduates. And after that, a slow but steady stream of blacks began to attend the university.
In the early 60s, when I came as a graduate student, the climate was a bit tense, but people were getting used to seeing a few black students around on campus. Things were pretty much still segregated.
Nobody wanted to sort of be with you or pal around with you. Now, what was interesting is, in a group situation, nobody wanted to play with you. But on a one-on-one, people were willing to talk to you, but not if their friends had to deal with it. So there was a lot of social pressure, I think, on the other students not to socialize with that person.
In the fall of 1966, Carolina underwent another significant change when Hortense McClinton joined the School of Social Work as the university's first black faculty member. McClinton remembers well the impression she made at commencement ceremonies later that spring.
I decided that I would put my robe on and march in the graduation exercise. And one other person from the School of Social Work, who was also a new teacher, decided she would march with me. And we marched in, and you could just see people stiffening up and turning around. And then when we sat in the rows that were provided for us in the stadium, we were singing this song, and one man just happened to turn around, and I really thought his eyeballs would pop out because he tried to look around at me, but not turn his head and just turn his eyes. I think he was very shocked to see me, the only black in that whole group of faculty members there at the graduation.
As was the case at all the major schools in the Deep South, the most celebrated people on campus were athletes. At North Carolina, names like Charlie Choo Choo Justice and Billy Kangaroo Kid Cunningham became legendary. Athletics were closed, however, to African Americans. That changed in 1963 when Nigerian native Edwin Okoroma joined the men's soccer team as a walk-on. Soccer was not a high-profile sport, so few took note of Okoroma. But the fortunes of the school's highly successful men's basketball team were followed by legions of fans and media. The team was the pride of Carolina, and it was all white.
When I first became head coach, my pastor at the Binkley Church in Chapel Hill, we had an African-American minister, assistant minister, and he said, "Congratulations, your first church work is to find an African-American player for the University of North Carolina." So it began then, and that would be 61-62 season, and I just didn't do a very good job. I should have, looking back, you're supposed to be have courage. I should have gone into every, at that time, segregated school in North Carolina and said, "Look, we're looking," and be on the lookout.
Smith found what he was looking for in 1966 in the person of Charles Scott. A native of New York and valedictorian of his high school class, Scott made the conscious decision to attend Carolina and became the school's first black scholarship athlete. He gained national recognition as an academic and athletic All-American. But for Scott, the role of pioneer was not an easy one.
I cannot say, honestly, that I had the same enjoyment of school life as any other individual had that went to the University of North Carolina at that time, because I just could not do all the things they did. I went to class with everyone, but when class was over, I went to basketball practice. When basketball practice was over, I had to do something by myself. I did not, because if I would have been with the other players on the team or any other individual, they would have had to change their lifestyle in order for me to be with them, because nothing in the South or nothing else had changed. The school had an inkling of maybe 5 or 6 or 7 different blacks there, but it still was the idea that we were not part of the whole structure of the University of North Carolina, of the social atmosphere of the University of North Carolina, or really of the city, because, I mean, there was still the aura of racism.
While Scott and other black students strove to prove they belonged, the African-American cafeteria workers fought for dignity and fair compensation. In the spring of 1969, black and white students joined their plight. The food worker strike came to a successful conclusion as 5,000 of the state's lowest paid employees received pay raises. Throughout the 70s and 80s, the university's African-American presence expanded in all areas. Deans and distinguished professors arrived. Rhodes and Moorhead scholarships were earned. Student body presidents were elected. Homecoming queens were crowned, and NCAA championships were won. The passion of the African-American student found an outlet in the Black Student Movement, an organization that, in the early 90s, was the force behind the push to have a freestanding Black Cultural Center. Construction of the Sonya Haynes Stone Black Cultural Center began in the spring of 2002. Now, as the University of North Carolina Chapel Hill settles into the 21st century, Carolina's Black community is energized and active.
And do we have some type of responsibility to let other students know, hey, this is something that you should be really excited about, you should really want to know about black culture? Or should we seek an active role of inviting students to come be a part of our membership and a part of our body and know that you don't have to be black to be a part of our body? The only way that you're going to grow is if you change some ideas. So I would like to form liaisons with other groups on campus that obviously believe the things similar to what we believe, social justice and diversity and equality for everyone.
We're not perfect, but we've done much better than we did, say, 50 years ago.
We've met the moral duty, I think, in great measure. Now, I'm not saying, and would never say, that we're done. No, we're not through.
I come on campus now and I see blacks as a part of the integral part of the university system, of the university's social system, which makes me feel very good.
I like UNC very much, and I'm a loyal alumni. I belong to the Alumni Association.
My daughter graduated from here. My son is going here. I hope my grandchildren will go here. I love the school. And there are things about it that I'm glad that I was a part in helping to change.
African Americans have emerged from the shadows at Chapel Hill to take their hard-earned and rightful place at the university. Publications such as Black Enterprise, Black Issues in Higher Education, and the Journal of Blacks in Higher Education have lauded the university as a national leader in black enrollment, retention and graduation, and overall diversity efforts. Among its peers, Carolina has the largest number of black professors with distinguished appointments. Carolina's black alumni include a congressman, a past chairman of the Board of Governors, a vice chairman of the university's Board of Trustees, over 600 lawyers, 400 doctors, scores of influential civic and business leaders, and several sports icons. Every year during Black Alumni Reunion Weekend, many black alums return to Carolina to reaffirm a shared bond and love of the school. During its 2+ centuries of existence, the University of North Carolina has been immeasurably enriched by African Americans. Without them, it would not truly be the University of the People.